Okay, good morning. All right. This is a reflection-based panel discussion around the 20th anniversary of the CDC environmental infection control guidelines. This milestone presents an opportunity to join the team responsible for developing these guidelines as they reflect on the journey behind the evidence-based standards. With a career spanning over four decades, our first panelist, Dr. Matt Arduino, has made significant contributions to the field as a microbacteriologist and a microbiologist. Our second panelist has demonstrated his continued commitment to maintaining the highest standards of cleanliness and safety. Mr. Aaron Jett brings a wealth of experience and expertise in infection prevention and environmental services. Finally, our third panelist, Dr. Lynn C. Holster, is an expert in environmental infection prevention, microbial inactivation, and the transmission of infectious diseases, who recently concluded a 20-plus year career with the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, and now provides consultation as the proprietor of Environmental Infection Preventions, LLC. After the conclusion of this presentation, please submit the session evaluation using the app. All surveys are available under your profile icon in the lower right corner. Now please join me in welcoming Dr. Matt Arduino, Aaron Jett, and Dr. Lynn C. Holster.
Where's Aaron?
Aaron's here in the back.
He turned it off
over to us.
So we got this.
We have this one.
Okay. We'll do it. Hi, everybody. I'm glad you are here. You're glad you're inside today? Oh, my. It's 106 out there. Can you hear me okay? Can you hear me now? Okay. Well, as you might guess, this is 2023, and that means that 20 years ago, this thing hit the market in the MMWR, a shorter version, but this is the full text version of this guideline. And what can I say? It was quite an experience for me personally and for others in the Division of Healthcare Quality Promotion, who partners with the Federal Advisory Committee, HICPAC, which stands for the Healthcare Infection Control Prevention Advisory Committee. And they are largely composed of, shall we say, physicians and nurses who have training in, again, infectious disease transmission issues and, what should we say, just basic doctor stuff and nursing stuff. The thing is that we have had a, there's our slide, okay. So we have had a number of people working at CDC for a number of years, plus colleagues throughout the biomedical research world. And we basically say there are a lot of people out there that we have totally been, grateful for knowing them and in some cases working with them. It's basically the giants of science. And the new people on the block are Dr. Arduino and me. And
I was the baby of the bunch when I joined the group in 1988.
And look at you now.
Look at me now.
And then I came on in 1996 as a person who was working in Texas, and one of the giants of science, Walter Bond, was a Texan working in Georgia at the time, and he said, "We need to hire her to replace somebody, a vacancy in our division." So that's how I came to CDC. But he had a reason for that, and that was because back in the early 90s and on and back into 1980s, I was working at the Texas Department of Health, eventually becoming kind of that person who had to respond to disinfectant and sterilization issues because there wasn't anybody else in the agency who had that kind of background. So anyway, we had a number of other people that we originally had lined up to be here, but due to technical difficulties beyond our control, they were unable to do their Zoom meeting style presentations. So I want to take an opportunity just to give you an idea who some of these folks were. There on the far left was Dr. Raymond Shen, who was an infectious disease epidoctor in Sharp Memorial Hospital in San Diego. And he was a HICPAC member during this time. And turns out he was the best candidate on the committee to be the advisor for the project that resulted in the development of the guideline. He was very active in a number of fields involving built environment and air and ventilation issues. So he was really a very good advisor, and I learned a great deal from him in the process. The big problem we had was he was saying, we need to talk about this a lot because it's going to change as things move forward. And I said, great, so when should I call you, or when do you want to call me? And he said, you know, I think I'm going to have to wait until the end of my shift at the day, which for him was 5 o'clock Pacific time. And here I am sitting in Atlanta with Eastern time and realizing, oh my God, I have to stay in the office at least until 8 o'clock at night to get his phone call. And sometimes those phone calls ended up being 2 and 3 hours long. And so I very rarely, during the production period of this thing, left the office before midnight. So I had a lot of days where it went from 10 o'clock in the morning till midnight or 1 o'clock in the morning. So it was a bit of a chore, but I enjoyed it after a while. Beth Stover is a good friend, a nurse, a pediatric infection preventionist at previously CoSara Children's Hospital in Kentucky, and she came down to CDC for a little while, but she was the go-to person as a nurse infection preventionist on that HICPAC committee at the time. She was very, very helpful with solving or being part of the representation that for CoSARES in a legal case that saved that hospital from a $20 million lawsuit because of her expertise in ventilation and the impact on the pediatric patient population. You want to do Andy?
And we should all know Andy Streifel from the University of Minnesota, who's an environmental kind of engineer.
Sort of.
Hygiene specialist. He does a lot of fungal investigations with HVAC systems. He's like almost like wrote the book about ICRAs, mm-hmm. and things like that. He was instrumental in the HVAC section of the document, mm-hmm. and he's even posed for pictures on the cover. So if you see the person with a mop on the cover of the document, it's Andy there. And he continues, even though he's retired, mm-hmm. he's still active in environmental infection control and doing consults, mm-hmm. Where there's issues around fungal investigations there.
So he stays busy, and will be busy for a long time. Yes.
Yeah. And
you want to do Doug?
Or no, you can do Doug.
I'll do Doug.
You do Doug. I could do Doug.
Doug Erickson is a person who I consider to be the built environment expert, and also very, very well expertise in the ventilation part of it all. So between Doug and Andy, those were our two main expert reviewers for the section that was really more of the built environment and the positioning of a hospital in the larger environment to take advantage of what direction is the constant airflow in your community, in which case you don't want to be downstream of that and just expect everything to be nice and clean and everything in your system. Doug was an interesting person to work with because he was very high up in the leadership of the sister organization to AHE, which is ASHE, and he was part of that group that was a committee member and so forth that involved preparing standards and working with other organizations in standard development. But the interesting thing about Doug is even though he was based in Chicago during those years, he actually lived in the Virgin Islands. So he was kind of hard to find at some point because he was going from one place to the other. So anyway, want to do Lenny?
And then Lenny was an EIS officer, one of our epidemic intelligence service officers in the division. He's now with the VA in Florida. A great ID doc, very smart, great reviewer of things, did a lot of international work in Vietnam and in Africa, knows his stuff, and it was a great reviewer on the sections of the document as well, from an infectious disease standpoint. And was always a pleasant person to work with.
He was a good colleague.
And a good colleague over the years.
And while working at the VA there in Gainesville, Florida, and he was also associated with Shan's memorial there, every now and then, either while I was still working at CDC or even in retirement, I'd get a call from Lenny, and he'd say, my goodness, I've used your guideline for so many things, and it's gotten our hospitals out of big jam. And I was saying, well, great, that's what we did it for. It's for you guys to use it. And so he was basically one of our best cheerleaders from the medical side of things. And so what can I say? As we move to the disclosures, first of all, I'll say that I basically don't have conflicts of interest because everything I do is in support of the material in this book. So I'm not conflicted monetarily or otherwise.
Yeah. And I work for the government. And he's I can't here. Have any conflict.
And he's here to help. But anyway, you are
okay.
Helpful.
So my turn.
Your turn.
Right?
No, I have.
Oh,
one
you have
more
some.
Thing.
You have a something too,
yes.
Right?
Yes. Yeah. Well, first of all, I just
oh,
wanted
wait
to.
A minute. Nah,
there
went
we
too
go.
Far.
I do want to point out we do have, as I say, a number of giants of science in our field. And sadly, all of these have gone on to better things, meaning like they have passed away. But you're familiar with many of these names, Dr. Spaulding with the Spaulding classification, which you all know. Judine Bartley, if you have worked with ASHE kind of membership with the built environment, she's the one who partners with APIC to produce a construction workbook which provides you with the information so that you can talk to either the hospital engineer or the facility manager or build a networking process with your multidisciplinary teams, especially with your infection preventionists. And again, Martin Favero and Walter Bond basically were at CDC encouraging the agency to adopt Dr. Spaulding's classification work. And furthermore, excuse me, Walter and Marty actually were among the very few people to add an addition to the Spalding classification where they made a, you might say, a category for environmental surfaces. Because the Spalding classification historically dealt with medical instrument surfaces and, the medical surface
And device, it's devices.
And devices. So anyway, the two people that we worked with were the ones who added the environmental, like the floors, the tabletops, every surface that you can touch by hand or foot in the hospital, which is your area. The rest of these names all contributed either to a research capacity or else, like Julia Garner, who was a CDC employee for DHQP, was one of the principal authors of the previous version of this in 1985, which was a much smaller document. And
yes,
what can
it
we
was
say?
Very smaller, like 5-6 pages?
Maybe so.
Maybe so.
A little bit, maybe 20. So anyway, so here we have a document. It's 20 years old, and it's still listed as a current guideline on the CDC HICPAC page on the website.
There have been some minor changes, over tweaks.
Tweaks, yes.
Tweaks.
But yeah. not so much.
Not so much.
I have a feeling that because of the enormity of this thing, CDC hasn't really done a lot of integrating the new material into the PDF version of the document, because if they did, they'd have to renumber all the references and a few other things, and I don't think they want to do that. But anyway, what happened was back in, 2002, the idea was presented to me that we're going to not, CDC was not going to print this document because it's rather big. But they were interested in putting something into the Morbidity and Mortality Weekly Report, which in this particular slide has the cover up in the far left corner. And what Matt was talking about are those two pictures on the front cover. Andy Streifel is the one holding a particle detector device as he's measuring the output from a filtration unit for a part of the building that was being remodeled. And then the picture to the right was one of the housekeepers, the EVS person that was happened to be in the area. And so I said, can we take your picture? Sure. And they've been memorialized on the front cover of the MMWR version. There in the far left corner is, if you go to the website, is what would be, you might say, the replacement for the cover page of this. So that reflects some of the things that they've been adding over time. Want to do some of that?
Okay. So what's happened since the publication of this? Well, there's a new, hand washing was separated out to its own guideline, which also, it's been a while since that's been updated. So the WHO actually published a guideline in 2008, since we published our own. There's been the built environment and engineering issues moved or separated out into this. So hand washing became its own. The built environment, our environmental infection control guideline went into theirs, which then took, you know, things from the TB guideline, the pneumonia guideline, the hemopoietic and transplant guideline. There were things that were incorporated from other guidelines that all went into our guideline. This big guideline has 7 sections, each a distinct topic. We added tools to help readers find content. So there's a table of content, there's an index, and the content has 3 main groups. you know, help for different groups of healthcare professionals. So we have, you know, for the medical specialties and nursing trained professionals, for engineering and facilities groups, and then for EVS professionals. So we have basically three target audience in that guideline.
So basically what this guideline does is it provides you with enormous support for the benefit of having the multidisciplinary team. Because in this document, there's something for each one of those three groups, and it's kind of like a one-stop shop. So you don't have to go from this guideline to that guideline to this guideline and so forth to find what you can find in here. So that was the good part of it, for sure. So we want to kind of maybe give you a sense of what further made the guideline unique or made it a better source of information. And I'm going to go section by section. But as you might guess, every time I was asked to give an update for HICPAC about what's happening with the document during its production time, you might guess that we had a couple of differences of opinion on some things. And invariably, how can I say, through my efforts, Matt's effort, or whoever was a content provider for the section, we would combine our thoughts together, so I would have an argument to make with a person on the HICPAC committee who wanted something different. And invariably, we won all the arguments because we had you guys' well-being and, shall we say, support helping us with this. And so let's talk about some of the things for the AIR section. This is the first one where we were able to convince CDC to support the concept of doing particle counting as real-time air quality measurements. Whenever you're doing an investigation for an outbreak, your facility manager or your ventilation engineer or maybe an industrial hygienist who might be brought into your environment are going to be doing particle counts because they're real time and they will tell you immediately, for example, if your filtration system is not working right. Part of the thing associated with the particle counting is one of the contributions from Andy Streifel, which was, as he called, the rank order of particle measurements. And the whole idea is that if you're bringing in outside air, which is going to be heavily loaded with particles of all varieties, and it goes through several filter banks on its way to the final destination as the supply air into any given room, the percent filtration for those filters will vary from letting in most of them to restricting most of them to, if you have a HEPA filter in the line, eliminating all but 0.3%. And so if you're trying to figure out if the ventilation system is the problem in an outbreak, then you compare what's in the outdoors to what is released into the room with the final filter bank. And if that doesn't match the percentage filtration, then you know something's off. Something's in the line with the filters. But I think the most important thing that we were able to accomplish over HICPAC's initial objection was that we would, in essence, endorse by reference and incorporate the standards of other professional groups, like the engineers or, what's another good one? I'm trying to think, water people, you know, so forth. Anyway, but the environmental standards from other professional organizations were important as sources of the references in this document because HICPAC's concern for any of the guidelines that they are produced under their direction, they would like everything to be very well referenced. And in so many things in the built environment, don't have a lot of references that are readily available and accessible by the medical community. So this is one way to get that information into a readable document. So HICPAC was a little leery of doing that. And I said, well, I'll tell you what, you wouldn't really pass a joint commission inspection or maybe a CMS review if your facility did not meet the standards for ventilation and water and other issues in the built environment, right? And I said, yeah. So that means you really need to implement those standards, right? Yeah. And you're using primarily category one references and recommendations for what you do during the course of your daily work, right? So I told the committee, we have category 1A and 1B, which are already in CDC guidelines. Let's establish category 1C to reflect the CDC's willingness to embrace the standards from sister organizations, and they said finally yes. So that's why you've got a lot of engineering information in this document, which helps, again, your hospital ventilation experts and your facility managers.
Even though those standards are set point in time, the guideline basically says, if you're following those standards, you keep current with those. It basically implies you keep current with those existing standards.
Right.
Regardless if we're saying you follow AIA, AIA doesn't exist anymore, it's now FGI. And if your state says, we adopt FGI 2000 and something, if you're in that state, then you're whatever its current is, you're current. And the dialysis section says you follow AIMI. Well, CMS says, conditions of coverage said, AIMI 2000 and whatever it is. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And if you're really paying attention, you're following the new AIMI ISO standard. And that's what most of the new, if you're DaVita or Fresenius or whatever, they're following, most of their corporate response is, you follow whatever the current AIMI standard is. And that's what CMS holds you to. Mm-hmm. So even though our guideline has a fixed standard because that's what's published at the time, doesn't mean, we're set here, doesn't mean you're linked to that standard in the past. You have to keep current with the current standards of the time. The standards move on. Even though our guideline is fixed back here, the intent is you follow the current recommended standards. If you know what I mean.
Water,
yeah.
That's yours.
Okay. So I'm the water guy, if people haven't figured that out. Just search my name. So in the water section, we added, really a bunch of a number of topics. We included, management of water intrusion and water emergencies, like what happens with flooding or water leakage, sewage backups into the facility because these things occur. We added content specific for the maintenance and performance and management of healthcare the cooling towers, mm-hmm. And that's a whole Legionella issue. I can reach over here. Okay.
There we go. Yeah.
So if I look at what was in the old guideline compared to the new guideline, well, there wasn't a whole lot in the 1985 guideline. We had some recommendations for the use of sterile water to rinse instruments and devices that are subjected to high-level disinfection. Just a blurb. There was a little thing about dialysis water, which is basically recalling the AMI standard, what AMI was recommending, even though AMI wasn't really called out in the old guideline. So it had the maximum contamination of 200 CFUs for water and the 2,000 colony count for dialysate. And then there was a short discussion about hydrotherapy. So this is your physical therapy tubs and tanks, about disinfection and operations from the point of view of those tanks. And that was it. It was not even a full page, just a short little...
couple paragraphs.
a couple little paragraphs. And then in the new guideline, we broadened that, you know, not only to discuss the water emergency stuff in the cooling towers, but we talked about the water distribution system and tap water. We had a whole review about, you know, transmission of pathogens from water. We had strategies to controlling those waterborne contamination, and we had recommendations to do that. And we had lots of recommendations, you know, for controlling the spread of waterborne organisms, for preventing waterborne microbial contamination within the distribution system. We still need to work on that. We have remediations for strategies to repair the systems or emergencies. We had additional engineering measures and what to do in epidemiologic investigations for controlling waterborne and healthcare-associated Legionnaires' disease. We had general infection control strategies for preventing Legionnaires' disease. We had we looked at preventing Legionnaires' disease in protected environments and transplant units. We talked about the cooling towers and evaporative condensers. We had a whole section on dialysis water and dialysate. We had ice machines. We talked about ice machines and ice, hydrotherapy tanks and pools. And then we talked about miscellaneous equipment. And here we talk about really dental unit water lines. We had a little blurb.
Just a little blurb.
Just a little blurb, because there was a bigger blurb in the dental unit infection control guidelines, which also came out.
Around 2003.
Around 2003. Also the same year.
Yeah.
And we're working on, and that guideline is actually being worked on right now by the Division of Oral Health and HICPAC. So, is this me or you?
Both.
Okay.
You can start off.
I can start. Okay. So here we are trying to win the debate, section by section, environmental services. This has been something proven over time for a long time. We know a clean environment, we don't have transmission. Clean hands, no transmission. Boy.
Who'd have thought?
Who'd have thought? But you know, this is the first time with this guideline that we recommended the use of EPA-approved registered products.
It was the first time where CDC, unbeknownst to them, actually declared we are partnering, in a sense, with EPA. And what they say, we will adopt. And that had not been published before.
No.
We kind of slipped it in so CDC didn't realize what we were putting them into. And I'll tell you, I'll just speak to the next dot there. There was a lot of concern about the fact that not all healthcare facilities, even in the U.S., have the financial support and the ability to buy products that are how should we say, even industrial research to determine their effectiveness for cleaning and disinfection. And it seems for time immemorial, the biggest concern was the quality of the bleach you might be using. Because you can buy bleach off the grocery store shelf and it will have basically the same formula as bleach products that EPA registers. But EPA is not real happy about the use of unregistered products. So we went back and forth and back and forth with the Division of Antimicrobial Affairs and whatnot. And we finally said, okay, we will support the use of registered products. But we'd kind of like at least the one caveat that if you are in a situation where getting a registered product is not going to work for you, then they would allow the use of generic products for your disinfection activities. But that was a major accomplishment, again, to get support and the camaraderie of EPA in this regard.
And the other thing here is dealing with fabrics and carpet, mm-hmm. and the clean ability of carpet in healthcare settings and or upholstery. Which, guess what, guys? You get blood and opium on, you can't clean that stuff. I'm sorry.
Well, you can try.
But no.
It doesn't quite work.
No. And what to do about mattresses and things like that. And it's still a challenge today. And convincing people there are places for carpet in healthcare, and it's not patient care areas. You can put it in public areas and keep it clean, but it doesn't belong in certain areas of the hospital. Mm-hmm. And yes, it's a challenge. It's still a challenge today. And the other thing we added a section on and a whole discussion about is the appropriateness of environmental sampling. Mm-hmm. Because we would have people going, we've done sampling and I found X. And I would say, why? And what are you going to do with
it?
And what are you going to do with that information? And why did you do it? And did you have a plan before you did it?
And the answer to those questions were crickets.
Yes. And so, you know, there's this whole thing about sampling and how to do it, what is the correct way of doing it, and this whole discussion. Because, you know, we don't live in a sterile world. We just don't. And you have to think about what are the modes of transmission? And how does bugs get from patient A to patient B? Because it could be done on devices or instruments or accessories. It could be on the physician, the nurse, the assistants. It could be on medical equipment or in surfaces or frequently touched surfaces or patient B in various ways.
And
you have to think, how do you break that chain of transmission? It's cleaning, it's hand hygiene, it's the reprocessing of the equipment. I mean, I did one investigation and you just followed the portable x-ray machine from room to room to room. And you went to the facility and they said, and you interviewed people and you go, who's responsible to clean that piece of equipment? Nursing did this. And I went like this. And I'm sitting there going,
okay, guys.
Excuse me. Oh, it's EVS. No. Nursing said, oh, it's equipment. It's not our job. And I'm sitting there going, well, you know, I work with the dialysis folks all the time. It's the patient care staff that cleans that equipment. It's the patient care staff. They don't leave, because it's done right after they treat the patient. They take care of that piece of equipment. There's none of this. Who's taking care of that? Before you go to the next patient, you're wheeling it to the next patient, you wipe that piece of equipment, you clean that piece of equipment before you go. So there needs to be clear understanding who does what with what pieces of equipment, and yes. So people just need, yeah, it's just terrible. So when we think about environmental sampling, we have to realize who's working up the samples, because it's not clinical microbiology. Because half the clinical microbiologists will look at you if you walked into the lab with an environmental sample and say, what the hell is this? I don't do this. Oh, no. I'm a CLIA lab. I'm not going to do this. The sampling is supported by epidemiologic assessment and should be directed, and your epi should direct your sampling. You just can't go in there blind. I'm going to do, what does the epi tell you to do? Mm-hmm. Only routine sampling recommended by CDC. Think about this. We only recommend routine sampling of one thing, water and dialysate and hemodialysis. Why is that? Because we have evidence that water and dialysate means something, because it's been linked historically to pyrogenic reactions in bacteremia and dialysis patients. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's the only place. Now, my Legionella colleagues will get upset, but that's them. You know, random undirected sampling is not recommended because it leads you to data that says,
what does this mean?
What's this mean? Yeah. I don't know. You know, sampling requires a protocol for sampling. It requires culturing and analysis of results. I mean, there's all these environmental labs out there that have all these tests for all these pathogens. What do you do with that data? I could PCR it. I have PCR results. You know what I tell people? I found a sequence. What's it mean? Doesn't tell me it's dead. I mean, doesn't tell me it's alive or dead. Just means I found a sequence.
Something was there.
Something was there, or is there. You know, before you sample, look at the literature and current activities. You gotta look at location accessibility of areas to be sampled. You need to look at methods of collections, appropriate equipment. Gotta look at appropriate volumes. If you're sampling water and you found something in a liter, what's the relevance? Is the infectious dose of that per mil? It's, you know, CFU per mil? Mm-hmm. Is it CFU or CFU per liter? I don't know. You know, numbers and replicas of samples needed. Number and type of controls. Half the times you get samples and no controls. Mm-hmm. What's it mean? You know, the parameters. And an estimate of maximum allowable microbial numbers and types of surfaces or liquids. And then you need a corrective action plan. What's your next step? Half the time, you get none of this. And then they want to know what to do with the results. I don't know.
Plus, it costs a lot of money.
And it costs this. Lots of this. And personnel time. Mm-hmm. Laundry.
Ah!
Scrubber.
Well, as a segue to the laundry section, I want to kind of point out that in the last 5 or 6 years, a lot of laundry folks are very interested in doing ATP testing on fabrics like gowns and bed sheets and whatever kind of fabric item that they're trying to wash for you, their customer and so forth. And they got into this notion of, hey, if we test it, we can provide, you know, something scientific to our customers and feedback. And apparently nobody kind of read the fine print of what is tested with the ATP method is it's looking for adenosine triphosphate, or the enzyme per se. And that is an organic thing. So you get a number, and then the company who makes your test system will give you a benchmark so you have something to compare it to. But anyway, after a point in time, they were using a product that was intended for hard surface sampling on porous surface sampling. And invariably, at that point in time, there was still probably a fair amount of 100% cotton fabrics in your facility. Well, guess what? The ATP test was basically picking up the organic matter, because cotton is an organic fiber. And so all your ATP testing of cotton materials were invariably skewed to the high end, and you thought, oh my God, I've got to wash this thing 1,000 times. Whereas the reality was that one washing of a fabric, if you follow the equipment manufacturer and the chemical manufacturers for the products and the instruments you use, will be perfectly fine. But that's kind of the thing that didn't really get across into even this document, because this appeared before ATP testing was really very big. But anyway, hospital laundry. There was a laundry section in the 85 guideline, but it was fairly limited to hot water washing and bleach, and that was about it. It didn't really talk about the fact that fabrics used in hospitals have now become a much more diverse array of fiber content. Well, what to say? Like in the built environment, there are industrial things that are moving forward, and yet this was kind of stuck in time. So we did have at least one reference that we could use to at least make the recommendation that you can do a lower temperature wash water and have a successful wash cycle if the chemistries in the detergent or some of the other additives are formulated to perform best at those lower temperatures. The other thing we kind of pointed out is if you use a lower temperature, and this is it's fairly obvious, you will save a lot of money because you don't have to pay so much on your energy bill to keep your boilers producing, you know, like 71 degrees centigrade water. That's kind of tough. But I'll tell you, really, when you think about it, this is an example of, again, maybe for HICPAC to consider. When I wanted to try and address some of these issues that the healthcare laundry industry were having, again, with working like with CMS, who was insisting that all hospitals do hot water washing and bleach, and that was it. Bleach was the answer. There's nothing else. Sort of post guideline, I was able, with the help of someone who is a well-known colleague of ours in North Carolina, who was acting as a outside consultant to CMS, and we, between her efforts and mine, we were able to convince CMS that it's okay to use things like hydrogen peroxide or even ozone to serve as a whitening agent and so forth. It's okay. But back in 2015, when Ebola was running rampant around Africa at the time, I was in the midst of producing a review article for the publication Infection Control and Hospital Epidemiology. And it appeared in volume 36 in the September issue. And it basically was like a mini review that really expanded upon the laundry section. And I discussed topics that were to give you a better idea of how the wash cycle works, the dry cycle, the different types of properties and intended uses for a variety of laundry chemicals. And I also got into topics which are really quite contemporary. One is, again, say the let's see, I'm trying to think how the best way to say it. The biological sampling of clean linens and bed gowns and bed sheets and gowns and so forth to determine what is hygienically clean. Now, I don't know about you, but even in this document, we did not have a benchmark definition of what is hygienically clean, because every surface is different from almost everything else. You're using different chemistries and physical processes, so it's not quite so patent that you can just say 20 CFUs per square decimeter is the number you'd shoot for. Above it, you're in hot water, sort of. Below it, hot water got things clean.
Yeah, and, but we have no definition for what is clean for anything.
That's true.
The only thing we have a definition for is what's sterile.
That's right, because sterile is absolute. That's the only thing in healthcare that's absolute. Healthcare is basically biology, and biology is gray. If you get into sterilization, then you're talking black and white. And these are some of the issues, too, in the engineering world. Again, going back to the reference to the lack of access to engineering articles, so it's not easy access for hospitals to, shall we say, subscribe to those journals, so you have the benefit of hands-on for those journals. But my argument, again, to HICPAC was, you say you have no reference or data to support the use of, say, a filter that is defined as a HEPA filter. And I'm saying the engineering world has done enough research in their own field to have confidence that, yes, a HEPA filter will do a reduction of 99.97% of the particles. And you're telling me that you're not going to accept that? So this was one thing that was a little difficult for HICPAC to accept at the time. But I think in the long downrange thing, they're realizing the wisdom of having access to those sources of information. So that review article could be a easy review update for whatever the new version of this is. You just, adopt it by reference, so forth. The other section that was really very interesting and new was HICPAC wanted us to add something about service animals. And it's kind of like, okay, there's not very many articles about service animals in the medical literature. So I had to go to the Delta Society and basically tell them we would adopt by reference some of their materials. And the two things that I think were really important were to include the animal-assisted activities and the animal-associated therapies, which again were fairly well laid out in the Delta Society world. But the one thing which was really a big challenge and quite a victory for you all was the fact that I don't know exactly how they became aware of it, but the Department of Justice contacted HICPAC and said, wait a minute, you've got a problem and you can't do this. And the thing they were referring to was the fact that when people have service animals, in many places of business, you see labels on the door, service animals permitted to access the property. So we were basically saying that service animals, not a good thing to have in an operating room or in a environment where, like a protected environment per se and so forth, and that's what the Department of Justice was angry about. So Ray Chin and I had to come up with an argument that would basically leave the Department of Justice saying, well, okay, was the notion that I said to Ray, if, let's look at it this way, if the general public is not allowed to go into the surgical suite without restrictions, you'd have a problem in your surgical suite, and your surgeries might be compromised. A lot of bacteria and fungi in there if you get traffic moving back and forth. Well, the same thing should hold true for service animals. You would not want an animal in your surgical room, right? So anyway, the point we made was if there are spaces or areas of the hospital where the general public does not have unrestricted access, then the service animal cannot accompany their owner or their person, however you want to refer to it, into those areas. That was a major accomplishment. And finally, regulated medical waste. Well, that's everybody's fun topic because, for example, in 2015, hospitals and medical waste treatment folks were having panic attacks. What do we do with Ebola coming out of the hospitals, you know? And both Matt and I got on lots of phone conversations with those folks. But basically, what was happening in the states is state environmental departments were usually tasked with regulating the waste categories that go to solid waste landfills. And medical waste was being, how should we say, expanded to a major topic ever since the needles washed up on the New Jersey and Long Island shore back in the early 80s for AIDS and so forth. So finally, there was a professional sort of association formed of the leaders in the various health departments for the states and the environmental departments for the states that dealt with medical waste management and regulation. And we adopted by reference a lot of their information, which made this a little bit more across the board, more information directly to you folks who might not have a chance to network with your state departments. And so we also tried to deal with the issue of, especially at the time of the pandemic influenza strain, what they were trying to do was encourage hospital laboratories to run a panel of unknowns, as they call them, for influenza virus, and they would be measured on their accuracy of their testing to identify the strain that was in the control group and so forth. And a number of those folks were told that after you were done with the panel assessment that you had to responsibly inactivate those before it could go out onto the landfill and so forth. But the problem they had was that many hospitals had outsourced their ability to do local in-house decontamination, and they got rid of all their lab autoclaves. So at that point, they were saying, well, what are we going to do? It's chain of custody issues. And someone had the bright idea that, well, let's just take our panel samples down to Central Sterile Department and use their autoclaves. And we're all saying, what? You can't do that. That's, no. Amy would not be happy. So we convinced them not to do that. And another item that needed some addressing was the disposal of materials used in the treatment of Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease patients, CJD. Waste managers and the owner operators of the landfills were terrified that everybody in the community would get CJD if they received wastes from the treatment of those patients. And we convinced them, you don't get CJD from waste. Sorry, it just doesn't work that way. So here we are, 20 years, and it's still in use today. Got a picture of the cover of the printed version, which, by the way, Ashy stepped up to the plate and printed this for us when CDC said they couldn't do it. the MMWR version, which we talked about, and we also have here just a picture of what pops up as the front page when you access the document online. Scan the box and you will be taken directly to that source on the web. What can I say? June, I think it was June 9th, 2003 was when the MMWR version showed up, and the print version of the whole document popped up a few months later. But I do have to say one thing about the whole process of producing this. Back in the late 90s, the default word processing program was WordPerfect.
Yes, it was. WordPerfect.
And it was a great program. And so I'm working up all this material in WordPerfect. And so after the MMWR version was released, then the thought was, okay, we're going to put the full text version on the web. And I went to the fellow in the division who was our web page manager, and I said, okay, I'm ready to give you this file to post to the internet. And he says to me, is it in Word? And I said, no, it's in WordPerfect. And he says, I can't use it. What?
Well, the rest of us were all using WordPerfect.
Yeah, well, they're all using WordPerfect. What's the big deal? So he says, no, it's got to be in Word. Okay.
And so, what were we using, RefMan? WordPerfect and RefMan?
They were using a reference manager software called Reference Manager, and it always screwed things up when you were trying to have an automatic numbering of your references. And the people in the division who had been working on the surgical site infection prevention guideline, which came out in 97 at that time, told me that I probably need to make two or three extra copies electronically of the document I'm working on, because every time you work with Ref Manager, it usually screws up something in your document, which you have to go back and repair. So I decided, well, no, I think I'll number the references manually. At least I have control over that. Anyway, so what I had to do was take this document and migrate it over a paragraph at a time to a Word document, what you see on the web page. And in doing so, as we talked about earlier, I was able to create the table of contents and the index, which doesn't normally appear in some of the shorter guidelines. A table of contents does, but not the index. And I can't tell you how many times when I got to a point where I was going to generate those pages electronically that I would say, okay, here we go, and it's like, ugh. And then I would look at the end result, and hey, it worked. It was great. The index was the one I was really worried about, but Word executed a flawless index, and I couldn't be happier. So anyway, this is what Matt has brought to my attention of more recently, and that is revisions.
So it's on HICPAC's knows it's due for a revision. It's on their priority list. We don't have a timeline as to when that will occur.
We don't know.
Is it going to be a big tome? Probably not. So we don't know. Right now, what is being revised right now is the dental unit infection control guideline, which will contain the dental unit waterline revision.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I could tell you right now.
So anyway, what can we say? I'm CDC past, he's CDC present, but not for long. He's going to retire soon. In which case, then you have him available to you as an independent consultant. Anyway, thank you for being here with our look back in the past and what we went through. But here's our contact information if you need to get hold of either myself or Matt. And as we say, thank you for being here. And I think there's lunch and learn, or lunch definitely, up in the other ballroom where the
balloons are.
The balloons are. So join us over there. There are several of you who are being asked to reflect on how this guideline impacted your career. And we should have some fun, plus something good to eat. So thank you so much for joining us this morning.